Obstetric Cardiology Resident. The topic for discussion today is anticoagulant therapy post PCI. So anticoagulant therapy in coronary artery disease is a wide spectrum that can be discussed at the variant in this following meeting. Anticoagulant therapy patients with medical managed coronary artery disease, those undergoing PCI, patient post PCI, anticoagulant therapy post PCI patient, and anticoagulant therapy the patient manages CMD surgery. The focus for discussion is going to be today mainly on the anticoagulant therapy post PCI patients. So why do we need such discussions? So even after almost after three decades of work and more than 35 trials including more than 2 lakhs of patients, the DAPT regimen remains inconclusive. The main problem lying that there are lots of data is available in evidence, but the interpretation remains questioned. The reason and the clinical practice in which we expect that a DAPT regimen should be formed according to patient profile and risk factor, it should be an individualized prescription, but hence the practice remains challenging because the study focusing on the patient populations are scarce, and so a specific studies that are intended towards a specific populations are very scarce, and those studies which are available, their interpretation is also questionable. What do we have? As of now, we have ECS DAPT guidelines 2014 and the updates, that is 2017 updates on that. But that guideline also has its pros and cons and it has various gaps, so that needs to be filled up with personal judgment and institutional guidelines. Now, this guideline has a recommendation in wide spectrum. It varies from class 1, that is something that has to be done, till the class 3, that is nothing to be done, and all in between, which should be done and which should not be done. So basically the journey of our question started in 1986 when the first stent was put in coronaries, and later on there came the different generation of stents with different molecules. And these are just two slides comparing the different profiles and their studies. The reason for putting these two slides was that DES has a different sort of safety profile and efficacy profile, and is there a scope for a different DAPT in case of different stents we are doing? We will briefly see antiplatelet agents and the pharmacology. So the mechanism of action, the aspirin inhibits COX enzyme and activation of thromboxane. The P2 white blood receptor inhibitors tipopidine, clopidogrel, prasugrel, cantharidin, and ticagrelor. That inhibits P2 white blood receptor present on the platelet and the attachment of ADP2 that receptor and further activation of the platelet. Newer antiplatelet baricitabine that inhibits the thrombin mediated reactivation of the platelet, and the monoclonal antibodies and tyrosine that activates the interfere with the final step of platelet aggregation. Mainly we are interested today in three oral antiplatelet P2Y12 receptor inhibitors, clopidogrel, prasugrel, and ticagrelor. Their pharmacokinetics in brief, all three are oral agents, while the clopidogrel and prasugrel are product. The ticagrelor is the direct active metabolite, so it has very early onset of action. Comparison of different antiplatelets with prasugrel achieves faster, greater, and more consistent degree of P2Y12 inhibition as compared to clopidogrel. Two-step metabolic activation required, and the final metabolite is the same to that of a clopidogrel. Now there is a comparison trial, Triton training, that compares clopidogrel versus prasugrel. We can see the primary outcome is better in prasugrel group, but the problem lies in the major TE bleeding. The rate is higher towards the prasugrel group. Ticagrelor, comparison of PETO study to compare ticagrelor with clopidogrel. You can clearly see that the primary outcome is better in ticagrelor group, and the rate of major bleeding is comparable in the both group, as well as the secondary outcome is better in ticagrelor. So on and on, the ticagrelor remains the better option. Now we come to the next part, efficacy and safety of dual antiplatelet therapy and the risk stratification tools. So current evidence suggests that the DAPT mitigates the risk of stent thrombosis across the whole spectrum from acute to elderly extents. However, the treatment with DAPT beyond 1 year after or after PCI exerts majority of its benefits by reducing the rate of spontaneous MI. Nonetheless, the PAPT comes with a bleeding risk, so it is necessary to weigh the risk against the benefit ratio. You can see the charisma trial here in the long, in which there was comparison between long and short term DAPTs, where the primary outcomes in the longer arm group is not good, as well as the bleeding risk is higher in the longer group. So we can say very long term DAPTs are on and on of less benefit, as well as carries the higher risk for bleeding. Six randomized test studies consisting predominantly of patient treated with test implantation and compared prolonged DAPT, that is 16 to 48 months of DAPT, with a short term or regular DAPT, 6 to 12 months of DAPT. And it was found that the additional 13 to 16 months of DAPT was related with absolute 1% and relative 63% relative increase in the major bleeding complications. Again, the Pegasus treatment trial compared regarding the clopidogrel use, 60 mg BD clopidogrel at the end of 3 years was associated with 2-4 relative increase in the major risk of bleeding. So do we have any tools to evaluate the patients who are likely to suffer from major bleeding? As per the 2017 ECS guidelines, there are given 2 scores, besides DAPT scores and DAPT scores. The first score is to be used at the time of initiation of DAPT. That includes 5 parameters, LPWC count, age, bleeding clearance, and history of prior bleeding. Each point, there is to be a line drawn towards the last score point line from each point, such as like this one. And the submission has to be done if the score is more than 25, then the patient is likely to have higher bleeding tendency, and the initiation should be started with a short-term DAPT in the group. While the depth score, that is for the continuation of DAPT, and if the score that has to be evaluated at the end of 12 years of DAPT treatment, if the score is less than 2, then standard DAPT has to be continued. If the score is more than 2, then the long DAPT can be given. Now, what is the level of recommendation for this course? So, the level of recommendation for this course is 2B and A. So, this course should be used in a patient under having DAPT treatment. What is the definition of high bleeding risk? And what are the patients who are likely to have high bleeding risk? The post-patient patient are at the high bleeding risk, at least following one of the criteria. Clinical indication, if the patient is on an oral anticoagulant, if the history of recent non-accessible side bleeding will require hospital attention, previous bleeding episodes will require hospitalization, underlying cause has not been definitively defined or treated, age more than 75 years, systemic conditions associated with brain diastasis, documented anemia, need of protein treatment with steroid and NSAIDs, diagnosed malignancies, history of stroke or TIA in previous 6 months, or a precise depth score of 25 or greater. Now we come to the part 2017 ECS focused update on dual integrated therapy in coronary artery disease patient management with PCI. So what are the classes of recommendation as per the standard guideline? The class 1 is something which is recommended or indicated. Class 2A, something which may be considered, and class 3 remains something which should not be done. The level of evidence, level A is from multicenter trials, data B, and we can see as for the standard protocol for that. So the guidelines provided DAPT management for 3 scenarios: the patient management PCI, patient undergoing CABG, and patient management medical management only. Our focus is mainly on the patient management PCI and the DAPT in that group. So it divides the patient in 2 groups, one the presenting with stable coronary artery disease and one presenting with ACS. Those who are presenting with stable coronary artery disease, again the patient profile has to be assessed. If they are having no high bleeding risk, then the DAPT should be given for 6 months, which is the class A recommendation, and at the end of the 6 months, patient needs to be evaluated. If there is no history contraindication for continuation of DAPT, then the DAPT should be considered for next 6 months, class 2B, level A recommendation as per the slide. Those who are having presenting with stable coronary artery disease, having high bleeding risk, the DAPT can be given for 1 month or that is class 2C level of recommendation, or it can be continued till 3 months, that is again class 2A recommendation. Now we are coming towards the ACSI, those who are present with ACS and those who are not having high brain risk, the DAPT can be given till 12 months, that is a class A recommendation. Those who are having high brain risk, the DAPT is recommended for up to 6 months, that is a class 2A indication for the same. In brief, again the recommendations, those who are presenting with CAD, again the 6 month DAPT is class 1A recommendation. Whatever the duration of DAPT might be for that patient, the DAS has to be used in that patient against the PMS. Again, the patient with stable coronary artery disease who have tolerated DAPT without bleeding complication, who are at low bleeding risk but high thrombotic risk, continuation of DAPT more than 6 months, maybe up to 30 months, that's a recommendation class 2B, something which may be done. This is the point of interest for today's discussion, whether it is actually needed or not. The patient with CAD in whom 3 months of DAPT causes safety concerns, where DAPT for 1 month may be considered. That is again class 2B recommendation, something which may be done. DAPT recommendations in ACS patient, again the 12 month DAPT is recommended in class 1A level of recommendations. The patients who are at high risk for bleeding, DAPT might be limited till 6 months, again class 2A recommendation. In ACS patient, this who have tolerated DAPT without a bleeding complication, continuation of DAPT for longer than 12 months may be considered. This is again a point of interest for today's discussion, whether this is, even if there is no bleeding risk, the continuation of DAPT is at all helpful or not. And the patient with MI and highest risk who have tolerated DAPT without bleeding complication, like low 16 for guidance, may still be preferred over proprioception or prioritization. This is again class 2B recommendation. Now, in brief, we will discuss the dual antibiotic therapy for patients who are undergoing over-antibiotic treatment. Reason for this discussion is that there are no separate guidelines available for DAPT patients who are at high bleeding risk. This would be the core use for that. Approximately 6-8% patients undergoing PCI have indications for long-term oral anticoagulants. The indications may vary, but as compared to those without having oral anticoagulation, the patients who are on the oral anticoagulation and needs DAPT are as 3 to 4 higher increase in bleeding risk. So there should be certain steps should be taken toward bleeding risk in those patients. For that, the patient systemic profile and bleeding profile needs to be evaluated, and the DAPT protocol has to be addressed as per those risks. So what are the features suggesting of high systemic risk? Any history of prior stent thrombosis or adequate antiplatelet therapy, stenting, and the last remaining patent coronary artery diffuse multiple disease. This is especially in diabetic patient who are having CKD. Patient with at least 3 stent implanted and those having 3 lesions treated, bifurcation lesions, total stent length of more than 60 mm or treatment of CTO. Unfavorable, the patients on oral anticoagulants were at higher bleeding risk. The profile includes short life expectancy, ongoing malignancy, poor expected adherence, poor mental status, unstable renal failure advantage, prior history of major bleeding or hemorrhagic stroke, chronic alcohol abuse, anemia, and clinical significant bleeding on your antibiotic therapy. So what can be the strategies that should be used in a patient who are oral anticoagulant and who are supposed to have DAPT? So the first thing is to assess the risk, bleeding and systemic both the risk using the various scores such as TATS-CVR score, ADC score, and HAS-CVR score. Second thing that can be done is keeping the duration of triple therapy, that is dual antiplatelet plus anticoagulation, as short as possible, considering NOACs or vitamin K antagonists for the treatment, considering target INR to be kept on the lower side of those patients. Clopidogrel is the P2Y12 inhibitor of the choice in those patients, and use low dose aspirin and including use of PPIs in those patients. These are again the 2017 ECS guidelines for the patient who are oral anticoagulant and require DAPT therapy. So, So if the ischemic rates are risk are prevailing, the integrated therapy DAPT can be given for 1 month. If there is no significant bleeding, then the integrated therapy can be continued till the 3 month. Both are class 2A indication. And again, there is one particular area of interest, that continuation of DAPT beyond 6 months in the patient who are normal anticoagulant. Is there a benefit or not that needs to be evaluated? Now, those who have higher bleeding risk, DAPT can be limited till 1 to 1 month, that is ultrashort DAPT. And the level of recommendation is class 2B. We come now to the main part of the discussion. This is ultrashort DAPT 1 to 3 months. For which patient and stents, now we have evidence. So these are in brief some trials that are done for the DAPT duration less than 1 to 3 months. First four, three trials are done for the ZDS, that is acronymous eluting stents. And all of the three trials, we can see there is either non-inferiority to the neck or there is superiority in the mesh with a shorter duration of DAPT, that is 1 to 3 months. These last four trials are including high bleeding risk group patient. Again, we can see there is some superiority in the primary outcome or there is non-inferiority in the same. These are again the trials for short term DAPT less than 3 months in high bleeding risk group. Actually, this most of these trials are now completed. This list was made in September 2018 when those trials were in enrolling form. Most of the trials are now completed, such as Petersfield trial, Master trial, recently updated, and on this trial. We will see those trials in brief. So, recent trial that we get 3 month dual integrated therapy following ZDS implantation. So in the test group, there was ZDS implantation and DAPT was given for 3 months. In the other group, there was a DES implantation and the DAPT was continued till 12 months. We can clearly see that the primary outcome is same in the both groups, while the risk of TME major bleeding is significantly low in the patient who are managed with just 3 months of DAPT, rather than 12 months of DAPT. So conclusion remains that the patient who are receiving ZDS stent with 3 months of DAPT, the composite outcomes were similar as compared to those with 12 months of DAPT with much significant lesser bleeding risk. The reduced trial, again, randomized trial for 3 months versus 12 months DAPT after implantation of bioabsorbable polymer stents. The reason for including this trial was that it includes the ACS group of patients and compares the standard 12-month DAPT with shorter 3-month of DAPT. The main finding in the present study among the ACS patient treated with combo stent that the 3-month of DAPT is non-inferior to that of the 12-month of DAPT. The finding is consistent with all subspecific groups included in the trial. Therefore, a shorter DAPT can be recommended in the ACS group also. The global leader trial, again, the objective of the trial is to evaluate 1 month of aspirin plus ticagrelor followed by 23 months of ticagrelor versus monotherapy with 1 year of DAPT followed by 1 year of aspirin. So, in the experimental group, there was just 1 month of dual antiplatelet therapy, while in the control group, there was 5 months of DAPT followed by single antiplatelet therapy, and you can clearly see that the group with just 1 month of DAPT had a better primary outcome, and but the bleeding risk were comparable in both groups. ZS trial, reason for including this trial was that this trial particularly included patients with high bleeding risk, and the test group was implanted with a ZDS stent. Control group had a BMS stent and both groups were evaluated for 3 months of DAPT. And the primary endpoint, we can see that the BMS group has, the ZDS group had, with just 1 month of DAPT, had a better outcome in almost all the clinical risk profiles. Senior trial, again, new parameter that the trial included patients with more than 75 years of coronary artery disease, and the test group was given the sanity test and the control group was given BMS, and the short duration of DAPT was evaluated in both groups. Primary endpoint, we can see that the test group had a better, that is dashboard with the synergy stem implantation and short 1 month of DAPT had a better all over risk cardiac outcome. We won't short DAPT study. Single arm study of 3 month DAPT in patient, again the study with a hybrid risk group patient with a 3 month of DAPT, and the conclusions for that study is where the favorable risk of ischemic outcomes observed among the hybrid risk group while the bleeding risk was significantly low in those patients who had shorter DAPT. Stop DAPT trials. Again, the objective of the study to evaluate 1 month of DAPT as compared with the 12 month of DAPT among the patient undergoing PCI. You can clearly see that the shorter duration arm, that is 1 month of DAPT, had a better primary endpoint and a much significant major bleeding risk as compared to the one with the 12 month of DAPT. And the master DAPT, that is the very recently published trial, and the objective for that trial was again to evaluate a very short term 1 month of DAPT therapy, and it's non-inferior to the standard or the 3 months DAPT therapy. The patients included were with symptomatic ACS undergoing recent PCI. You clearly see that the primary outcome was better in, or comparable in the shorter 1 month DAPT group, while the risk of major bleeding was significantly low in the 1 month DAPT group as compared to the standard 3 month of DAPT group. So the conclusion for today's presentation that the DAPT one size fits for all doesn't work. Cannot give the standard 6 month, 1 year DAPT to all the patients. It needs to be individualized approach based on patient's clinical profile, ischemic and bleeding risk profiles. The guidelines, the data available needs a thorough meta-analysis with a selective subgroup of patients to provide different guidelines. We can, these are my interpretations, but we can discuss this part actually. This patient with stable coronary artery disease with no high bleeding risk group, the 2017 ECS guidelines recommended 6 months of DAPT class 1 indication and again extended 6 months of DAPT with class 2B indication. My inference on the day would be a 6 months of DAPT is good enough. We need not to be for coming for another 6 months of DAPT disregard of bleeding risk presence. We can comment, we can discuss on that part. If there are any comments on that part, that is the first group. 2017 recommendation was 6 plus 6 months of DAPT. I would recommend a 6 months of DAPT is good enough as per the recent evidence, whether the bleeding risk is present or not. The second group will be stable coronary artery disease with a high bleeding risk present, 1 or 3 months of DAPT.